Good morning, students. Hope you all are fine, staying safe at your home and studying well. For most important, studying well. See, children, today we are going to begin the part third of this chapter 4, that is photosynthesis and respiration, subtopic photosynthesis. And today we are going to complete this lesson. So, first of all, let us see the overview, what all we are going to study today. So the concepts are factors affecting photosynthesis, end products of photosynthesis, fate of end products of photosynthesis, utilization of glucose synthesized and its transportation, significance of photosynthesis. Students, factors affecting photosynthesis. What is a factor? A factor is something. It can be an environmental factor, biological factor, chemical factor, anything. It can be anything. A factor is something that affects the rate of any process, any phenomena. In case of photosynthesis, the factors are those environmental factors that actually control the rate of photosynthesis. When I say control the rate, I mean they either decrease or increase the rate of photosynthesis. So we have some factors very important that we are going to deal with now. There are three most important factors that affect the rate of photosynthesis, students, and they are carbon dioxide, light, suitable temperature. These are the three factors. Now, all these three factors are independent. They don't depend on each other, children. They independently affect the rate of photosynthesis. For example, higher the concentration of carbon dioxide, higher will be the rate of photosynthesis. Because more the amount of CO2 available, more will be the rate of photosynthesis, because this is one of the raw material for photosynthesis, remember, children. So the more it is available, the more photosynthesis will take place. Next, light. Which light? Sunlight. Higher the intensity of the sunlight, higher will be the rate of photosynthesis. That means more the availability of sunlight, more will be the rate of photosynthesis. Third one, suitable temperature. Students, there is a particular temperature, okay? Neither very high temperature nor very low temperature has good effect on photosynthesis. Both are harmful for the process of photosynthesis. The exact temperature or the optimum temperature that is suitable for photosynthesis to take place range between 35 degrees Celsius to 40 degrees Celsius. You can note it down, children. 35 degrees Celsius to 40 degrees Celsius. So all these factors, although they are independent, children, they have their own independent effect on the rate of photosynthesis, but still all of them are very important altogether. Next is end products of photosynthesis. Children, you all already know, we have done in the previous class, there are two end products of photosynthesis. One is glucose and the other is oxygen. Oxygen is actually not the main product, it is a byproduct of photosynthesis which is produced along with glucose. Fate of end products of photosynthesis. Now here the word, what is the meaning of the word fate over here? Fate generally means what? Destiny. Luck. Kya hota hai? Future mein, isn't it? So here fate applies like what happens to the products of photosynthesis. We have got two products, one is glucose, other is oxygen. what happens to glucose and what happens to oxygen after their synthesis. Children, glucose formed during the process of photosynthesis is either immediately utilized by the cells of the plant body or is stored in the form of insoluble starch. Now, what is starch? Do you know, children, what is starch? You must be knowing that it is the higher form of glucose. What is starch? It is the higher form of glucose. Just try to understand. I am showing you one diagram. This is one bead, suppose. Then I have got another bead, one more bead, again one more bead, and finally one more bead. Bead means moti. So they all are connected to each other to form what? To form a necklace. So end to end they are connected to each other. One molecule, just try to compare it with starch. One molecule of one pearl or one bead of this necklace is like one molecule of glucose. One molecule of glucose. Try to understand what I am saying, children. So C6H12O6. Now, how many are there in this case? 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Isn't it? So, 5 beads or 5 pearls of the necklace. We are comparing them to molecules of glucose. If only one is present alone, such molecule is called a monomer. If more than one is present, we say polymer. So, in case of starch is nothing but it is like the necklace, and glucose is nothing but it is like one bead of the necklace. So many beads together, they combine to form the necklace, and similarly, so many glucose molecules, they join end to end with each other. Suppose this is one glucose molecule, then the next glucose molecule, then the next, and so on, the chain goes on. So they form long chain compound, higher form of glucose that is insoluble in nature. The glucose itself is soluble in nature, children, but when it forms this type of chain, it forms starch, that time it becomes insoluble. So glucose is soluble but starch is insoluble in water. I hope everything is very clear, children. Just let me excuse me, children, let me erase. Now let us see the next one, that is oxygen. So I hope, children, glucose is clear. Glucose, what happens to glucose? Some of the glucose is utilized by the cells of the plant body and the remaining is stored in the form of insoluble starch. Starch is insoluble in nature, but glucose is soluble in nature, and that is the reason that it can be easily transported to the different parts of the body through the phloem in the form of a solution. Next is oxygen. So what happens to the oxygen, children, that is produced as a byproduct during the process of photosynthesis? Some part of this oxygen is used for doing cellular respiration. Okay, what is cellular respiration, children? Breaking down of glucose in order to release energy inside the cells is called cellular respiration. So some part is used for respiration, but a large portion of it is not required by the plant body. So what happens to that? That is diffused out of the plant body into the atmosphere through the stomata present on the leaves. Next is utilization of synthesized glucose and its transport. See, children, just now I told you that some part of the glucose is utilized by the plant body. How it is utilized? For doing cellular respiration. And for doing cellular respiration also, what is required? Oxygen gas is required. that is also produced during the process of photosynthesis only. So all the cells of the plant body, they require the glucose prepared during the photosynthesis. Phloem vessel is associated with the transport of the food, that is glucose, from the leaves to the different parts of the plant body. But glucose is formed rapidly by the leaves, isn't it? Glucose is formed, the process of photosynthesis is very fast, children, you can't even imagine. It is so fast that the number of molecules of glucose that is produced, it is much more faster than the rate of utilization or conversion into starch. So it cannot be transported at the same speed at the speed at which it is produced. So the pace of production of glucose and pace of utilization of glucose is imbalanced. It is not equal. Next, that is why several molecules of glucose, they undergo polymerization. Just before some time I taught you children, what is polymerization? Joining of several glucose molecules to form what? To form a long chain compound, and that long chain compound is your starch. That is insoluble in nature, and in simple words, what we can say, that glucose is stored in the form of insoluble starch. At night, this starch is reconverted back to soluble sugar. Why so, children? It is converted back to soluble sugar, that is called sucrose. Why so, children? Because at night there is no photosynthesis, but the cells of the plant body, like any other living organism, they continuously perform respiration. They continuously perform respiration for 24 hours non-stop. So a very important questions you must have come across in your previous classes, that does respiration occur 24 hours or it occurs only during the daytime? So the right answer it occurs 24 hours. Photosynthesis doesn't occur 24 hours. It occurs only during the daytime when the sunlight is available, because without solar energy, photosynthesis cannot start. The first step of photosynthesis process, that is splitting of water after activation of the chlorophyll, requires solar energy, but at night there is no sun, no solar energy. So that is why what happens, since there is no photosynthesis, no synthesis of glucose, so what happens, whatever stored amount of starch is there present in the plant body, that is reconverted back into soluble sugar, and this form of sugar which is reconverted from starch is called your sucrose. Okay, sucrose, glucose is different, sucrose is different. And this sucrose, it is then again transported to the different parts of the body, to each and every cell of the plant body, through the xylem, through the veins of the leaf, and through down through the phloem of the stem as well, till the roots. Till the roots, children, till each and every tip of the plant. On reaching the target site, what happens? This sugar is either utilized by the cells to produce energy or is once again reconverted back to starch. So try to understand, children. Wait. Suppose I'm drawing a rough diagram for you. Suppose this is a plant, okay? The roots are underneath inside the soil. This is the stem and this is one branch. And here I have drawn one leaf borne on this branch. Suppose the food prepared from here in this leaf went through the phloem to the different parts of the body. Suppose it came to this branch. Suppose this is another branch. The food reached this branch. Suppose this branch. And here what happened? The food is not required by the cells of this branch of the plant. Then what will happen at this site, the sucrose will once again get converted back to starch. This is what happens. Not only this, suppose this is potato plant, okay, then you all know very well that potato grows under the ground and potato is not a root, children. For your surprise, I don't know whether you know or not from your previous class you have studied or not. See, potato is not a root, although it is under the ground, it is a stem. Why? How can we say that it is a stem? Because it has got nodes and internodes. So, what happens in case of potato, carrot and all, whatever extra sucrose is there, when it reaches these sites, they get stored. And due to gradual storage of the food, that is sucrose, and conversion of the sucrose into starch, they enlarge in size in the form of tubers. In case of potato, in the case of potato, we call it tubers. Modification of stem in potato is known as a tuber. So they will increase in size by gathering more and more starch. Starch from what, beta? From sucrose. I hope this is very clear, students. Next is significance of photosynthesis. See, when I began the chapter, I told something that if there is no food, there is no energy. No energy means no work. So photosynthesis is very important, children. Why? Because green plants are the only living organisms on the planet Earth. They can prepare their own food. Rest of the organisms, including us, we all depend on plants directly or indirectly for food. So the first significance of photosynthesis is that it is the ultimate source of food for all living organisms on planet Earth. This is due to the process of photosynthesis performed by them. Since they are capable of doing photosynthesis due to the presence of chlorophyll, that is why they are the ultimate source of food for all life on Earth. Next, what? Photosynthesis, children, it is the only natural source of oxygen for respiration. There is no other process in this universe which naturally produces pure molecular oxygen gas. Photosynthesis is the only natural process that produces free oxygen. Okay, and there's a spelling mistake over here, sorry students. Okay, and it adds it to the atmosphere and purifies it. Because when we say purification of air, what do we mean? We mean addition of oxygen to the air. Okay, students, with this we come to the end of this session. Hope you all understood everything, and still if you have any doubt, do let me know in the comment box. And if you really feel that yes, my classes are useful to you, then do like the videos and subscribe my channel. Do not forget to press the bell icon in order to get all the notifications related to any video uploads or live classes. That's all for today, children. Thank you.